Hello, everyone. I'm Lieutenant Rod Grassman, Public Information Officer for the Sacramento County Sheriff's Office. I'm joined here today by Captain Parker Wilborn, Public Information Officer for Sacramento Metropolitan Fire District. Metro Fire and the Sheriff's Office want to share with you an overview of an incident that occurred in Sacramento County this last June. Sheriff's Office deputies responded to a call for service regarding a 911 hang-up call, a very common occurrence. This normally innocuous call turned violent when a subject took his 2-year-old son hostage by holding a knife to his throat. He then started a fire in the room where he was barricaded with the child. Once the fire was ignited, Sacramento Metro Fire District responded to the scene and joined the Sheriff's Office in a complex and chaotic scene that demonstrates the dynamic ingenuity of your community's first responders. What you're about to see is nothing short of an extraordinary rescue.
Responding personnel from both Sacramento Metro Fire and the Sheriff's Office have distinguished themselves through their unwavering devotion to duty. While the actions performed on the scene are significant, they're just a microcosm of the commitment, dedication, and cooperation between the Sheriff's Office and Metro Fire to keep our community safe. Metro Fire and the Sacramento Sheriff's Office have worked together to bring you this 50-minute video from the perspective of responding deputies and firefighters. All videos being released have been minimally redacted to ensure the confidentiality and privacy of those involved. Audio redactions are signified by a muted audio with no accompanying sound. This is an active investigation. The information provided in this video release is preliminary and subject to change as investigators learn more. Some of the video you're about to see contains strong language, in addition to graphic content, which may be disturbing to some viewers. Viewer discretion is advised.
I was dispatched to a 952, which is an incomplete telephone call. We get those a lot, 952s. Usually someone's hanging up, or you'll hear some like screaming in the background. Doesn't give much information. So my partner, Deputy Vicente, and I, we show up to the apartment. The text of the call read that there was a small dog barking, I believe, and there was a woman like crying or screaming. So that's all that we had to go with when we first responded. Knocked on the door, received no answer. I checked the window and I was able to see someone pacing back and forth. It was a middle-aged woman. I let my partner know. Knocked on the door again. Finally, she came out. She answered the door.
She walked back. She's walking back and forth.
Nothing.
just based off of her, like her facial expressions and her body language, like you can tell that there was something wrong.
Hello. What's going on?
The father's in there breaking stuff with my son in there. I need you guys to get him out.
Okay.
Yeah. Seems.
Can you just keep an eye?
Yeah. Okay.
So
my son's a 1-year-old, okay? I've been trying to tell him to leave, and he won't leave.
Okay, does he live here?
No.
Okay, where does he live?
In West Sacramento.
Huh?
In West Sacramento.
Okay, and he's...
He's supposed to be on visit with my kids, and he's not leaving.
Okay.
And we had a couple drinks together, and he went a little far.
Mm-hmm.
So I asked my daughter to go use the phone upstairs because he broke our phones.
Mm-hmm.
So we're not allowed to call. So he's in there. If he knows that you guys are out here, he's going to flip a script and keep my kids in there and hurt them.
Okay, so...
I need to, like, go back in there so he doesn't hurt my kids.
Okay, wait a second. Is there any weapons in there or anything like that?
No.
Okay, can we go in there and talk with him?
Please.
Okay. Do you have a restraining order against him or anything like that?
As she was entering the door, I noticed that there's like a large red marking on her left side of her back. So in my head, I was already thinking, you know, there's probably a domestic violence that happened sometime, you know, earlier in the day.
Where is he?
He's in the back room with my sons in there.
Okay. Are they asleep?
Yes.
So they're asleep.
My daughter's not. She's in her room. And my son's asleep. I don't want to hurt him.
Okay. Does the door locked?
It's broke.
It's broke?
You'll see it.
Okay. What's his name? Okay.
Please, don't let him hurt my son.
Broken door. Is it with the broken door? Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. Hey, call for another unit. Hey.
Man, can you
put the knife down.
Give it there. Can we get three additional
people? Hey, come here. Leave that kid. Okay, come here.
Get back.
Hey, put the knife down, man. Come here. Listen to me, man. Hey, I just want to talk with you. Let me see the kid. Hey, he's a child, man. Let me see the kid.
He will do it.
Hey, stay inside the room. Stay inside the room.
Out.
Hey, no, that's not what we want to do, man.
No, you want to fucking.
Hey, look. Hey, guns go away. I just want you to put the knife down, man. Come here. Let me see the kid. Put the kid down. Hey, guns will go away, man. Hey, guns were gonna go away, dude. I don't want the kid to get hurt, man. Come here. Listen to me, man. Hey, please, dude. I'm asking you, please. Let me see the kid, man.
You fucking did this
for... Frank is barricaded in the back bedroom.
Hey, speak with me, man. Hey, look at me, dude. I just want to see you.
Nope.
I just want to make sure the kid's okay, man. I need to see you, man.
Take a look.
Hey, well, I need you to come over here.
No, no, I can't.
Get out.
Get out, please.
Don't do it.
Save my baby.
Poor King Frank is trying to ramp to the back window.
Mom!
Get out.
Please.
Out. Where is he?
Let him go.
Look at my goat. Do you have... Okay. Look, it's down. It's down. It's down. Look.
Look at the window right now.
Okay, it's down.
Tell me, get away from the window.
Don't.
Oh, over there.
Where?
In this, right here. That bedroom, brother.
Hey, get off. Step on the side.
Out.
Right here.
Out.
You get down now.
Went to the apartment. I see Duran. He's got his gun out. And I still don't know really what's going on. I peek around the corner, like I said, and I don't see anybody there. I don't see anything that's going on. So I'm like, okay, what's he doing? Who's he talking to? Who is he giving commands to? And then out of nowhere, just just pops up out of nowhere, right behind the dresser.
Yo, yo, yo!
Hey, hey! Stop! Hey, dude, let me talk with you. Let me talk with you. My gun will go away, man. Okay?
Get off the air!
Hispanic.
Get off the air!
Let, please. Okay, look, my gun's going away. Okay, look, my gun's going away. Look, look, listen to me. Okay, look, it's down. It's down. Okay, look, it's down.
What's his last name?
What's going on, man? Look, hey, I'll put my gun down. Take me off. Take me off. Hey, look, listen. Look, I'm putting my gun away, dude. Okay? I'm putting my gun away. Okay, look, look, my gun's down. I just don't want that knife next to the child, man. What's going on? What's going on? What started all this?
She started punching me.
Okay. Is that, does the child?
She drank half a bottle of fucking alcohol.
Okay, so check it out, man. Let's put the kid down and let me talk to you about this.
I'm not gonna put the kid down because I already know what's gonna happen. So go ahead and get the kid to negotiate.
Okay, well, check it out, dude. I just want the kid to be okay. That's it. What's your child's name? What's your child's name? Hey.
Very stressful environment where you have him screaming at you. You're more concerned about what's going on with the kid. You see him, he's ducking behind the child with the knife to the throat. It's just one of those situations where if you haven't been there, it's not fun to be in.
Do we have units inside?
Yes. There's Duran and Madison.
Okay. What can we do to stop this? What can we do to stop? You tell me. What can we do to stop this? You tell me.
Kidding again. Knife on the other.
Talk. Hey, let's just put the knife down.
Yeah, right here.
Let's
and shoot.
No.
Right here, shoot.
No.
Shoot.
Hey, that's
please
not what we want to do.
Shoot! Shoot me!
What?
Shoot me right now! Shoot me!
No! Stop!
Shoot me!
Please!
Shoot me! Please!
Let me just speak to you with the knife down, okay? I'll put my gun down.
Shoot me!
I'll put my gun down.
No,
that's not what we're doing.
We're not trying to hurt anybody. We're not trying to kill.
Focus on me. Focus on me. Focus on me, man. Hey, this is not what we want to do. I want to talk with you, man. That's it. Okay, can we put the kid down?
As a supervisor, my first thought was this is the worst case scenario that I could think of because no matter what decision I make, no matter what I push, there's always that chance that he starts making good out of his threat. And now we have a possible death that my decision could have caused. It kind of, I saw that and it was immediately, oh no, you know, what do I do? And so, soon as I kind of listened a little bit and saw that deputy was able to kind of ride the roller coaster, get him where he was amped up to calm him down a little bit to the point where he was crying and lowered himself down out of our view, but did not show immediate desire to harm the baby. I kind of backed out a little bit, called our watch commander, let him know what was going on, and immediately said, hey, we need to pull the handle on it. This is time to call everybody that we can.
Please. No, that's not your way out. That's not your only way out. Talking with me is your way out.
And so I, at that point in time, tried to run back and forth in and out, trying to coordinate, make sure we had a perimeter set up. So,
hey, dude, come on out. Hey, he's got the baby in his arms. He just came to the window. He's got the baby in his arms.
Still holding the kid?
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's no avenue escape, so we can look at all of our options, so we can kind of keep trying to formulate some type of plan. I started to kind of gather a team, an arrest team, where if we were able to talk the knife down, someone that we can go in there using our less lethal options to try and take him into custody. I was looking at if we had the opportunity, do we need to use lethal force to end it?
We're not doing this, no.
We had one deputy in there with a assault rifle who I kind of kept eyes on him, watching him, seeing and he just kind of indicated to me that it just he never had a clear opportunity. Like I kept the baby close to his head to where he, talking to him later, he never felt comfortable doing it, and I wasn't going to push the issue because if he didn't feel comfortable, take him away.
Come here, man. Come here. No, not, that's not what we're doing. Look, at you got a beautiful kid right there, man.
I know I got a kid right here.
Okay, he's a beautiful kid. Let him come out, man. You don't need to be doing this. Okay, what do you want to talk to about?
Let's talk about this, dude. Let's work it out. We don't want anyone to get hurt.
You hear me? Hey, hey, dude. Okay, well, what are we going to talk to? What are we talking about?
Dude, I'm not fucking with you. One more time.
No, what are we talking about, man? What are we talking about?
What was that?
He keeps on throwing stuff. No, stop. Stop. Hey, listen, no, we're not doing that, dude.
Get the fucking light off of him.
Look, stop. Hey, come here. No, we're not doing that. I just want to talk with you, dude. Have you had anything to drink tonight?
I don't want to talk to him more.
What can we do?
You can't do nothing.
No, there's something that we can do. You tell me. Tell me what we can do. I'm reasonable, man. Talk to me. Talk to me. Talk to me. What can I talk to you about, dude?
I want to talk to someone else.
Okay, who do you want to talk to? I'll get someone else over here. How about that? I'll get someone else. Who would you like to talk to? Would you like to talk to another deputy?
I want to talk to someone else.
Okay, who? Who would you like to talk to? Tell me, man. I'm listening.
My wife.
Okay, your wife. What would you like to tell her?
I was trying to build rapport with him. And he was going up and down. He would start to listen to me, and then he wouldn't. He'd start raising his voice, start yelling again, and then, he'd calm down. It was just back and forth, back and forth.
Let's talk about this.
What's his name, bro? What's his name? Huh? No. Hey. We're not doing that, bro.
We're not gonna do that, dude.
No.
We're not gonna do that.
Please, just shoot me in the head.
No. We're not doing that.
It's not even working,
no.
Man.
No. Hey.
Shoot me.
Let's talk about, what do you want to tell your wife? Come here. Hey, it's okay.
Do we want to get the apartment behind it?
Yeah.
That one? Somebody go.
No. Listen to me. Hey, your kid loves you, man. You know that?
I was just trying to keep him there as much as I could. So my partners could formulate a plan. I knew that they were already working, they were already doing, their job. I can hear him talking, in one ear, talking about, entering on the side of the apartment complex. So I knew that they were formulating a plan, so I just needed to continue talking to the guy.
Come here. Hey. Hey, your child's right there. Listen to me. I need you to stop screaming because you're scaring your child. I need you to listen to me. Yes. I need you to listen to me. Okay? You got your child in your hands and he's down there with you and you're scaring him. You're scaring him. Hey. Listen to me. You're scaring him. You need to be the man. Okay? You need to show him that you're strong. Okay? Let's not scare him. He's your child, dude. He's your child. Okay? Let's not scare him. Okay? Dude, this is something that we can figure out. Yes, we can, dude.
We can.
Yes, we can, bro. I'm telling you. Yes.
No, we can.
What is it that you want to talk about? Okay, let me have your child, dude. Let me have the child, man. Hey, bro. Bro, please don't throw anything at me. I'm just here to talk with you, dude. I haven't done anything to you, nor has that child. Okay? Huh? Okay, well, what are we going to talk to the wife about? Tell me, bro.
My wife, sir.
Hey, talk to me.
I won't talk to no one else.
Okay, well, we'll get your wife in here, but come on, dude. Let me see the child, dude. You're scaring him, man. He's just a little boy. Look at him. Okay, well, what would you want me to do right now? Tell me. Help me help you. I'm not lying to you, bro. I'm not lying. Who would you like to talk to? Okay, well, what do you want me to do? Huh? What do you want me to do? Hey, bro.
I told you I want my wife.
Okay, well, your wife's outside right now, dude.
I told you I want my wife.
What are we going to talk to your wife about? Stop.
My wife.
Stop. Your child's right there. He doesn't need to be inhaling that.
He went into the restroom and he grabbed an aerosol, like, can. I think it was like a hairspray can. And I could hear like a flint going off. And I'm like, oh, no. So Flint was going off, and he started to spray something, and I was telling him, hey, stop spraying
right
that.
There,
you know, that's it's not good
that.
For the kid to inhale.
Listen to me, man. Listen to me, dude. Your child's right there, bro. Hey, bro. Hey, can you stand up for me? Hey, can you stand up for me?
I told you I want someone else.
Okay, well, you don't want to talk to me anymore?
No, I don't.
Well, you want to talk to another deputy?
It's worse.
How am I making stuff worse? I'm just trying to talk.
Nope.
What can I do? Hey, bro. What can I do?
He continued to do it, and he started a little small fire with, you know, some debris that was inside of the restroom. After he got the fire started, he threw whatever he had in his hand, I believe on top of like a pile of clothes, which was next to the bed. And once it landed on the pile of clothes, you know, it ignited. Clothes ignited and it started
catching the bed on fire. I need you to come out and talk with us. He's lighting a fire. Stop, dude. It's okay. Look.
I told you I want someone else.
Okay, who do you want?
Someone else with you.
Okay. Who else wants to give it a shot? Okay.
So, just try talking to him, trying to just maybe vent to us, see what's really going on. By then, I'm thinking, okay, now this is more of our SED, our SWAT team. If we can get him there, they can kind of take over and do what they do best. But then it kind of escalated into him lighting the apartment on fire. As I looked at Duran and was like, hey, do you see that? And he's like, yeah, he's lighting something with the aerosol can.
Why not?
I know how this ends.
How is it going to end?
I know how
this ends. No. What you're thinking is probably going to shoot you. It's not going to happen, man. It's not going to happen. Okay? Our concern is about with you and the child, okay?
Yeah, my wife, I already told you.
Okay, like my partner just said, what do you want to talk to your wife about?
Then the fire started. That added more of a, what the hell do I do now? Yeah, now it's just up the game to where we have to do something. Do I force him to go in now and take the chance of the same outcome of him harming the baby? Do we wait it out, fire builds, and we lose our opportunities?
That's it.
Hey, yeah, couch is on fire, everything's on fire.
We got fires.
Okay.
You got a knife to the child, we can't push it, because he's putting the knife to the child's neck.
So right, but...
I understand that, but right now, if we start pushing too far...
Hey, your son can't be in there, dude.
Yep.
Your son can't be in there. There's smoke in there. And there's smoke in there. Your kid doesn't need to be smelling that.
Come on.
Yeah.
Fuck.
Hey, dude. I need you to listen to me right now. Okay. I need you to listen to me, dude. Hey, I need you to listen to me right now. Hey, the kid doesn't need to be in there with that smoke.
The place was catching on fire. We're talking about it. We're letting our partners know, hey, you know, it's catching fire. It's getting bigger. It's spreading. There's a lot of smoke. Eventually, it got, you know, so bad where, you know, the smoke was, you know, above our heads, and fire alarms going off. Partners are still, you know, formulating the plan.
The wash commander, in the meantime, he showed up, and we both had kind of looked at the side sliding glass door that led directly into the bedroom. posed a problem because of that's part of where the fire was at. Big window that we had to breach to get through. But the main hallway where they were talking to him, the door was broken in half, but he had also partially barricaded it.
Hey, bro. Next thing I know, he's the whole inside of the bedroom. You can see the sparks or the lights coming off the wall. You start to see more and more smoke.
Listen to me.
He started to think, like, okay, this is getting much, much worse. We're going to have to act. Otherwise, the child's going to die.
Dude, what's Carlos?
Yeah.
Listen to me, bro. Your son can't be inhaling that smoke.
Oh, right?
Do we want to get close to him?
Okay, okay. Just calm down. Calm down. And calm down. He doesn't need to be.
Hey, you gotta bring us the kid, man. You gotta let the kid go, dude.
Hey, he doesn't need to be in there. He didn't do anything.
Let's have one person. He's trying to shut him out of the room. Hey,
I need you guys out. Everybody out. Get everybody from inside.
Exit.
Hurry, please. What you need, Sarge? Huh? The wife was right here. They told me to put her back. You want her?
Okay. No. We just want to find out the bathroom. Is there any other exits out of the bathroom?
Okay. Is there any exits out of the bathroom?
No.
Any exits at all? Any vents that somebody can like crawl through?
No.
Nothing. Just the slider in the
slider.
Hallway.
In the window. And her bedroom.
You still there? Hey, bro, are you still there? You still there? Hey, dude.
Out that way, please. That way.
Hey, there's too much smoke in there.
Yeah, I know.
Come on out, man.
You're my wife.
Dude, the kid.
Hey, man, your wife's out here. We don't want anyone to get hurt, dude. We just want to come out and talk to you. We don't want your baby to get hurt. That's the biggest thing, all right? Right now, you're not making this like. This is low level, man. We can still recover from this, but we need to get out of here.
No, I fucking can't! Get my wife!
Dude, we need Where's Sarge?
He went running that way. I don't know. What do we need?
This fire's getting. There's too much smoke. There's too much smoke.
Hey! Listen to me! Your kid!
Bro, you gotta lose your kid, man! Let him go!
Hey.
Listen to me! Hey, we gotta go now.
We gotta go.
Sarge, we gotta go! Hey, this fire's getting big.
I know, we need to go in now.
Let's go!
Come here!
The decision was made by the watch commander to go through a sliding glass door, which I agreed with. And then it was a matter of setting up a team and trying to get our tools there that we needed. That posed a little bit of a delay, which helped but harmed us. It helped us because it allowed the fire to gain enough momentum that it caused the hostage taker to kind of panic, not worry as much about harming the baby and standing off between us as opposed to what is he gonna do. So it kind of threw him off his game a little bit, changed his mindset. However, it posed a problem that the fire was bigger and we had to get through it.
Too much smoke.
They're inside there. I can't see.
Get out. Too much fucking smoke. Fire's still burning.
Have fire come in.
I got it.
Come in. Here's the fire.
It's right. It's still at the bottom.
And keep eyes on. Go. Get that extinguisher. Huh?
Is
no.
We got another extinguisher on the
Here. Right here.
Here's another.
Sorry. You're good. Find me a napkin.
Where's fire at? Does anybody know?
They're calling for it now.
Hey! Grab more extinguishers, grab gas mask.
Is he still alive and moving?
Yeah, still alive and moving. Had baby and I have both of them right now.
Okay.
Hey, we need to move.
Good. You want to get tapped, dude. Let us know.
Good.
There's a wall right there. He's inside of the bathroom.
Yep.
It's way too much smoke. I can't see anything past the second pillar. So if you go in, I can't see you at all.
Did we evacuate upstairs?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Let's do it.
Kick in this door. Try and get back to where the back bedroom is. It's a fucking bust out. See what we have to do to break through into the bathroom.
Got it. All right.
What?
141. 141's empty.
241?
141's empty. We have no fucking choice but the hole right now. No, because then if you get fucking smoke insulated and you drop on the bed, then what? It's not fucking worth it, dude.
Okay. Where is this? I don't know what this is.
Triangle parallel to where the bathroom is, which is that far back wall. To the left.
Four.
Right here.
Oh, God.
Can you just... Brandon.
Well, we determined that they were going to be at that point stuck in that back bathroom and decided that our only means of potentially getting to the child was to access that vacant neighboring apartment. And so we forced entry into the slider. And we utilized our breaching device to pretty much knock a hole in that wall to try to get to them. We were able to knock a hole into that wall, through that wall into the bathroom where they were both at.
Yeah, so we'd been dispatched by PD. They'd requested us to come out. There was a report of a violent crime assault that we'd gotten on our MDC. Knowing that those situations can go erratic pretty quickly, we decided to move up and stage. We staged at the intersection, I believe it was Jackson and Madison. There's a little gas station right there. So we were staging there. We knew this could go a lot of different ways. We've gotten reports that he possibly was trying to set some stuff on fire. So we were kind of talking about different options. We were looking at the complex guides, kind of going over what the layout might look like.
All right, grab the can. I'll update.
dispatch came up and said, clear to enter, fire is spreading, requesting fire. And this is from their relay from PD. So we went in route, we balanced it to a full commercial structure assignment. As we're approaching, we make that hard left-hand turn into the apartment complex, and for those who are unfamiliar with it, it's a one-way in, one-way out, just a full loop U. So usually you make access to the one-way in and follow it all the way around. That was our plan, to make that same access as we had done in the past. I was a little frustrated. We rolled up on scene, only to be hit by a sea full of cop cars. I think I counted them out to be about 15 cop cars that were sitting there blocking the road.
Keep pushing.
Go.
Keep doing it. Keep trying to break it open. Get
it. Watch out.
As soon as I made that turn, we were hit with a glow. You know, we could tell that there was obviously a well-developed, well-seated fire at this point. We had cops running by. We had what I assumed were people, residents living in other apartments in that complex, crossing us, going the other direction, getting out. So there's a lot of stuff going on, a lot of different moving pieces. As I advanced up towards where the fire apartment was, I came across one of the police officers who was talking to my firefighter, Tucker Hodge. He indicated that the person, that the people involved, there was a child and an adult, had barricaded themselves within the master bedroom and then again within the master bathroom that was located in the corner of the building. He'd indicated that some of the police officers had already made access to the apartment next door to it, had broken a window, and were trying to get access through the adjacent bathroom. I looked over at my firefighter, told him to go grab a chainsaw.
You know, it was very hard to see. Visibility was a little shoddy. But we did see the male from inside the bathroom attempting to cover up the hole that we had created with insulation and, I guess, an attempt to limit our visibility or...
With the development of the fire, with the fully involved first floor, the well-involved second floor, and knowing that it was probably a common attic that we had for this complex, this was had the ability to spread very rapidly. You add in the complication of a rescue, those are additional resources that are going to be task saturated and doing other things. So it was right off the bat, second alarm being called. I think in a half effort to give a size up, with that was also, this is spreading, we're going to need a second.
Which apartment is he in? Right here. He's just on the other side of this wall. Is there a bathroom? He keeps covering up. If we can get that cut down so we can get him out.
Get a team to stand by.
What?
Get a team here to stand by.
I need a team in here to help fire.
Did we get the people in the back?
I'm not sure. I want at least 2 to 3 people in here for fire. When they cut a hole, we can go in and deal with it if he starts
fighting. Okay.
Okay, fire's en route with the... if you guys stand back here until fire starts working.
Yeah, sorry.
That's fine.
Door open?
Yeah, they're in there.
Yep. Watch out.
Hey, Sergeant, I'm not going to shoot him if he's holding the baby.
Does he have a weapon?
Yeah, a knife.
He has one hostage, a baby.
Fire attack. No, I mean, this is part of the city.
goal. He's barricaded himself with that. He's got a cell phone.
I go in there. As soon as I start cutting, the bathroom that we're in starts automatically filling up with smoke. It's a thick, dense smoke. And I hear the cops behind us. They start coughing. They start having trouble breathing just because everything is filling up with smoke so quickly. As soon as I start cutting, the saw dies out on me.
Evacuate,
we need to get out.
All right. Hey, can you guys see in there?
Can you see?
No, we can't see.
Copy that.
Finish my cut. It's taken a while for me to get through this wall. I realized later that it's a pretty thick wall that I was cutting through. Ended up being two by fours on edge that were toenailed together with two layers of sheetrock on both sides. Plus I was cutting through electrical. I was cutting through the plumbing because it was right above the toilet seat. So it was taking a little bit longer than I thought it would. As we're clearing stuff out of this wall, we're pulling sheetrock out, we're pulling debris out of this wall so I can get in there. And as I'm reaching in, I'm checking my arms. I'm checking, you know, it's like I'm not cut yet, okay? He's not there waiting for me, at least not that I know of. At that point, the smoke lifts a little bit and I'm able to look inside and I'm able to see a foot hanging out of the bathtub. The subject was in there in the bathtub with the water running, and he had his left foot hanging out and he had one arm hanging out of the bathtub.
Again, passing officers along the way. Some of them were crouched at the doorway. Some of them I had to encouraged to not come with us. But I do make the decision that we are going to make a search, and we were given the assignment for search and or rescue, at this point, rescue of the known victim. So I start our search for the child in the unit that's involved with fire, and the unit that the victim and the adult assailant is known to be in. I make entrance with Engine 24, who's the nozzle and attack team at that point. So we're doing a search off of a hose line, but we were able to eventually search the entire fire unit, with the exception of the end of the hallway. This particular unit had a master bedroom at the end of a hall that was, and that door was the master bedroom and bathroom behind that barricaded door that the victim was known to be in. During this time, I knew that 42 was in the Delta 1 exposure, the exposure that shares a wet wall and shares a bathroom wall with the fire unit. They were making their breach and entrance through the other unit. So as that was occurring, we were searching the fire unit. I got reports from 42 that they had made the breach and completed the breach through the bathroom wall. That was about the same time we were at a standstill with our search. I was confident we had searched all areas with the exception of the master bedroom and bathroom at that point. So when I got that report, I told my firemen, we're gonna go back out the fire unit structure and make our way to Delta 1, is what we call it, and that's gonna be the unit that they made access into the bathroom from.
So I hop in there, I see the bathroom door is barricaded, and there's crap everywhere. There's stuff all over this bathroom. And I scan the floor real quick with my flashlights just to see if I can see the kid. I do a quick scan before I hop down. I don't see anything, but I know he's there to the right in the bathtub. I do notice that he starts to move a little bit. I could see one arm hanging out of the bathtub, but I couldn't see his other arm. His other arm was actually underneath him, still in the bathtub. I reach down, I end up grabbing his arm that I can see to secure it, and I grab his right behind his neck just to hold him down, making sure that if he is conscious, he's not gonna come swinging at me. I see out of the corner of my eye to the left side of him, still in the bathtub, I see a foot sticking out. I pushed the guy to the side, so I was able to grab the kid just by the shirt, and I yarded him out just one-handed. At that point, Captain Lemon was right behind me.
Jim, let's fire now, bro.
Which way?
We made that commute from the fire unit to the Delta 1 exposure. And in that transition from the fire unit to the unit that 42 had made access from, the baby had been handed off from 42 to officers, and an officer then handed that baby to my fireman, who then I lost my fireman to completing that rescue and delivered the baby out to the medic unit.
Medic! Switch!
Made my way into the breached bathroom wall about the time that 42 was trying to package the large male adult, 250-pound-ish male adult, in the bathtub.
Together, everyone was communicating really well. We all kept a level head. I'm proud of all of them.
Like we've had conversations and just sitting at the table earlier, you know, trying to figure out, okay, where are these people at now? How are they doing now? And we all have personal feelings about the gentleman, but at the same time, if somebody asked me would I prefer he lived or died, I would absolutely say I'm glad he lived. I'm glad we were able to make that difference and pull him out and keep him alive. Because everybody deserves those second chances. We don't know people's circumstances or what's going on. And it's not really for us to judge as much as sometimes we do. But I think at the end of the day, that's why we do this job, is to help people regardless of the situation. And I think that was an opportunity for us to do so.
Like I said, if it wasn't for the partners and
fire department coming through and everybody knowing what they had to do. It could have went to a different outcome, but it didn't, and saved the kids. So.
It seems like as in the fire department that if we were to pull up like we normally would on any house fire, we would pull a line, we would squirt water on the fire, and as the fire goes out, things get better, and we would try to make a rescue from there. If we didn't get the intel that we did at the point, I don't think we would have made those decisions. And if those decisions weren't made, I don't think we'd have two surviving victims. I think we'd have two fatalities.
You know, despite fire knowing that there was somebody armed in that room with the baby, and you don't know what situation you're getting yourself into when you jump into a dark hole with somebody with a knife. It could have ended bad, and they didn't care if the rescue of the child was, at that point, the most important thing.
And it was a team game, even with it. Once the victim was found and the two-year-old was hands-on victim, it passed from fireman to officer to fireman. So it was certainly a team game.
It took probably later on that night after I got home that I was able to kind of relax and think. The adrenaline kept me up for probably 2 days after that, almost living on no sleep because of I wasn't able to relax. It took a while for me to really think and realize that our actions did something, mattered to somebody.